Ramez suggested that while he sets up, I tell you a little bit more about ourselves and our lives in Egypt. Excuse me. When we moved to Egypt, we had two children. We were moving from Montreal, and I had become a Canadian citizen, by the way. So we had two children. They were 3.5 and 7.5, and we've been there 44 years. So it's very much home. We're looking forward to going back in 2 weeks. But now we've been in North America for, it'll be 2.5 months by the time we go back. The longest we've been away from Egypt for many years. We actually, last time we came to Montreal was 7 years ago. So I don't know if many of you were here, but we were at Bethel. I think at that time it might have still been Bethel Chapel, right? 7 years ago? Anyway, in Egypt, we live right above or right below our daughter, Leila, who was widowed fairly young, and we're helping her to raise her two children. They are now 15 and 17. But here in America, we have our son who is working at the University of New Orleans as a geneticist. So that's kind of, he's got three kids, but they're much younger. And are you ready, Ramez?
I'm really ready.
I can keep talking. No problem. I can always keep
talking.
I'm
ready if the AV people.
Ready? So I will go sit down, right?
Okay.
Later on.
The passage we heard this morning is incredible. I mean, it's mind-boggling, even though you know it, and you've read it many times, you still say, wow, that this would happen. And our theme, Rebecca and I, today is nothing is impossible for God. We have seen over these 44 years many things that we thought were impossible. We didn't even dream of what God could do, and we were privy to watching God do things we couldn't imagine. So this theme fits us. The disciples couldn't imagine what would happen or how to feed these 5,000 people. It wasn't in their mindset. They couldn't figure it out. And yet God did a miracle. So our theme this morning is the impossible, and we share some ways, some stories of a few things out of hundreds that were impossible. So there was an impossible task to feed 5,000 plus women and children, and Jesus' disciples had another solution. The disciples were returning from a mission trip. They had gone to serve without Jesus, healing and exorcising people, and Jesus was going to go on a retreat with them. He was mourning John the Baptist's beheading. They were tired. They didn't even have time to eat because they were so busy. So they planned to escape from the crowds and have a retreat with Jesus. It seemed logical. It seemed fair. It seemed that this was the right thing to do. And many times in life, Rebecca and I felt that when we think something is right to do, God surprises us with something completely different. So they had planned to escape, but the crowds caught up with them. I noticed as the passage was being read, they ran. It was, you know, Jesus' disciples took a shortcut on the boat. The people ran and caught up with them. 5,000 people running and catching up with them. It's just, as you imagine it, it's mind-boggling. And Jesus, his first reaction was he had compassion on them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. That was his first reaction. Many of us would have said, oh no, the last thing I need is all these people. I need time alone. I need to restore myself. I need to, and this was very disruptive from them. Let me go on. Oops. So, yeah. I call it disruptive compassion. Jesus had compassion on the crowds, but the disciples also had compassion. They said, they're going to starve here. They've been out all day listening to you, giving your long sermons. Why let them go into the towns to eat? They sort of accused Jesus of not being sensitive enough to the people's needs. It's getting late. How are these people going to get back to their homes? How are they going to eat? In real life, as I say here, many of our neatly ordered lives are disrupted by needs we cannot ignore. And living with 10 million people in Egypt, these needs are very many. the compassion that God gives often disrupts our lives as he encourages us to get involved with needy people around us. Now, Rebecca is going to come and share one of the areas she ministers in among Sudanese refugees in Egypt and how a recent situation has really disrupted her life.
7 years ago, I'm sure when I was here, I spoke to you about the garbage village and about the center of love for special needs that we've built at the garbage village. But I decided today not to do that, simply because I don't have enough time to talk about everything, and also because you have all been so helpful just in the last few months raising money for the Sudanese Displaced Children's Learning Center, the SDCLC, and for helping us to improve our breakfast program. I've been working for many years with Sudanese refugees in Cairo because we just have hundreds and thousands of them. And most recently, oh, not here yet. What's this? It's not in the right order. Sorry. Most recently, what should I do? Should I just go forward and skip that? And then, yeah, we don't know what happened. But anyway, I'll tell you about this other thing in a minute. No, it completely went away. Okay, never mind. Most recently, in the Family Fund, which are actually our community church, our English-speaking community church has in Cairo, for Sudanese refugees, we have a lot of wonderful, wonderful ministries for the refugees there. And I am thinking that possibly when I get to the end of the next part, it might show what I want to show you about the Family Fund. So why don't I go ahead, Ramez, tell them about the 8 children, and then hopefully it'll come back maybe somewhere. We don't know what happened. Anyway, out of the Family Fund, because I was working for so many years with Sudanese refugees, when a Sudanese pastor found 8 orphan kids and allowed them to come and live in his school, sleep on the floor in his school. That happened almost a year ago, by the way. Knowing that the school had to open in another month or two, he called us in the Family Fund and said, "What can you do? Can you do anything to help me with these kids? I can't just throw them out of the school in a month or two. And they seem to be orphans. I haven't really been able to find out. And they're young, and they're teenagers, and I don't know what to do." So a group of us started visiting them, and we fell in love. We totally fell in love. These kids were ages 2.5 to 15. There were 8 of them. They were siblings, except the two oldest boys are the first cousins. 6 were siblings. They did not know where their mom and dad had disappeared to, and they still don't know. We still don't know for sure. We're quite sure their dad is dead, the dad of the 6, and we know for sure the dad of the two, is dead. The mom of the 6, we don't know where she is because she went back to Khartoum to get one of the other kids. Khartoum is the capital city in Sudan. And then right where, after she went back, the war broke out. That's the war that broke out on April the 15th, 2023. And she, we don't know. Is she dead? Is she alive? Nobody knows. Hundreds and thousands of people have died also just in this war that is still going on in Sudan. So, like I said, we fell in love with them. And what I wanted to say here, too, it wasn't just a thing of love. It wasn't just a thing of, oh, my gosh, we have to do something to help these kids. It was also kind of like God just put it on our laps. He said, this is what you got to do. And I was already 76 at the time. And I was thinking of kind of beginning not to retire, but to kind of like think, I'm kind of like retired. and it was like God was saying, oh no, you're not going to retire. No. Get that idea out of your mind. It was disruptive compassion. We love the kids, but God gave us the compassion. So we kind of adopted them. You can't adopt in Egypt. It's illegal. It's against the law. But in all intents and purposes, our group of five, and you can see them up there in that picture. They're the, let me see now, are they all there? No, they're not all in that picture. You'll see them later on in another picture, all of them together. Our group of five started visiting them every week, getting them clothes, and then finally we rented an apartment for them, furnished it with mostly secondhand furniture, but good furniture that they could be comfortable in, three bedrooms, which to a Sudanese family, three bedrooms seems really big. So many of them live like in one or two bedrooms, big families. So we also had to find them substitute moms. So the Lord helped us to find two wonderful ladies there. As you're looking at that picture, there's one's over there on the right-hand side. One lives with them all day, and one lives with them at all night. And the little ones of the children have started calling one of them mama. So to me, this is wonderful, that at least the little ones can have a mama that they think is the real mama, that, you know, it's... Anyway, the Lord has been helping us to work with them this year to help them to just get used to Egypt. They were new to Egypt. Help them to get into schools, help them to start even learning Arabic. The two older boys were from South Sudan. They did not know Arabic, so they had to learn Arabic. And anyway, it's just been one of the most joyful experiences I've ever had. I go to visit these kids, and I sit there, and all around me is noise and confusion and lots of different languages, and I just sit there, and I feel this is pure joy. This is what pure joy is all about. But it wasn't my idea. It wasn't my compassion. It was the Lord's. And he kind of came into my fairly neatly ordered life and disrupted it. And I just praise him for it. I'll just go through the pictures now that you see more of them. Here you see all the five original team members. They're all Egyptians. And one of them made this video when we got the children into their new apartment, into their home.
The disciples had come back from seeing God do things through them that they'd never imagined. They drove out many demons, they healed people, and yet when Jesus, they told Jesus, they couldn't conceive of what Jesus could do with these people. So they told them they can go back and buy something for themselves to eat. They were trying to say, as I said earlier, Jesus, have compassion on them. And Jesus said, you give them to eat. It's a bit like Rebecca was, you know, the last thing she needed was another ministry. I mean, she has three enormous ministries with their boards and budgets and bank accounts, hundreds of people, very different ministries. And yet for her to do something like this was out of her, I mean, it didn't make any sense. You give them something to eat. And they say, it's impossible. It would take eight months of a man's wages. Can we spend that money on bread to make them eat? They had a little purse. They could probably have spent it, but they didn't want to spend it on these people. There was no way Rebecca and I could have dreamed of what we saw God do in the last 44 years. And I'm just going to share briefly about the work of a Bible society where I've been involved for about 34 years. For the last 3 years, I've been retired as a CEO, but I work as a consultant, advisor. I go to the office 4 days a week, and I'm still very involved. Now, when we first began in 1990 in the Bible society, there were many, many restrictions. My predecessor told me, you can't open a bank account. Stick to our old bank account that was in the name of the British Bible Society. And you can't raise donations because we're not legally allowed to collect donations. And you can't, and you can't, and you can't. So it seemed impossible. There were dozens of impossibilities. We lived in a Muslim country. You can't give out literature free of charge. You can't evangelize. And our bookshops were dusty bookshops. Anyway, I don't have time to tell you all that happened, but I'm going to show you a video that explains a little bit how the byline we used was said, when a door is closed, look for a window to jump through. And I can assure you, we jumped through many windows. And in Egypt, you have a lot of windows to jump through. So very often, they say impossible, and then you find another way of doing it. So the word impossible was not in our vocabulary. If God called us to something, we believed he could do it. So just listen to this video. So today we have here, oops, what is happening? I've lost this. I think I'm on, if you give me a minute, I think I'm on the wrong PowerPoint. I will try to, because we're missing, Rebecca's big, we're missing my, that's very frustrating. Most of you know how frustrating it is to, one of the things I've learned over years is that if you trust God, he does things you couldn't imagine would happen. Like now. And he uses it for his glory. So you put up with my patience here. Your patience, I mean. But my patience also. We will do it. There's always a backup. Said, if something goes wrong, I will have it. And I'll whiz through it. And this hopefully will be the right one. August 10th, that's last night.
If it opens. You have patience. I don't. There we go. We'll whiz through this now. Quickly. And yes. I'm finished. I'm on. I'm on. Fortunately. Okay, we'll have a right order here. This was what Rebecca was going to show you about her work among the Sudanese, out of which this ministry came. So, Becky, I'll just go through it and show you that, okay? So it's this ministry that the pastor brought these eight orphans too, and came and said, hey, you guys work with people, help us out. They feed people, they take care of them, and Rebecca's been doing this with this team, a different team, than the team of the orphans for the last 25 years. This is a spiritual program of that Sudanese ministry. Every week, they serve about 30 families, and over here, about 400 to 500 families. And they have a service for them. And through this, some of Muslim women have come to know the Lord, as they come from time to time to worship there 3 or 4 times a year. They're singing about Jesus' love for them. And you can see how enthusiastic they are. These are poor women, destitute women, many of them with 5 or 6 children, living on their own, many widows, many people who literally don't have food to set on the table. Some of them lock their kids up in the apartment when they go to work in house cleaning. We've had tragedies happen. So it's been a very bittersweet experience for Rebecca, as every week she comes back burdened with needs she cannot meet. I will move ahead because of the time. And here, Rebecca wanted to thank you all for all you've done, particularly to improve the breakfast program at another ministry, which is the school for 300 Sudanese refugees. There's no connection between the two. Different boards, different groups. The only connection is Rebecca, who's chairman of the board of Yavon. And that's the 70s. Okay, well, here we are. So when Jesus said, you give them to eat, it was an impossible thing. And that's what Rebecca and I have felt. So in the Bible Society, the government restrictions, the church in Egypt mainly is a Coptic Orthodox church. They accused us of proselytizing. They said, you're a Protestant group, and there was a lot of resistance at first. But it's a church that loves the Lord and loves the Bible because they've had a Sunday school movement for 100 years that has raised a generation of Coptic Orthodox people who are very committed to God's word. And when you attend the Coptic church, there's a lot of smells and bells, and you don't realize that behind it is a real commitment to God's word. So I say that we at the Bible Society have had to meet the insatiable hunger for the Bible in the church in Egypt. And the other churches also have revived. And I was telling someone, you maybe instant know, the second largest and most active denomination in evangelism, in ministry in Egypt, are the Closed Brethren. They have, the Open Brethren have about 6 assemblies, the Closed Brethren have 240 assemblies, and they're extremely serving. They have changed because of the need. They saw the need, so they went and filled the need in a remarkable way. Many of our staff come from the Closed Brethren. So, and then to hire staff, to raise money, to produce products, to do distribution impact, it was very difficult, and because my time is gone, I'll just let you listen to this video. Whoops. Maybe you can raise the sound a bit.
The Bible Society of Egypt exists to make the scriptures available and accessible to all at an affordable price and in a language people can understand and in ways and programs that can help each one grasp the message and effectively apply it. Established in 1883, the Bible Society of Egypt is the largest Arabic Bible publishing operation in the world. We are serving the largest and oldest Christian community in the Middle East, committed to equipping the local church with the scriptures, working together with all the denominations to deepen and affirm Christians in their faith. Our vision is to see Christians in Egypt united around God's word and living as a testimony to the gospel in their communities. Each year, we distribute over 2 million scripture items, from complete Bibles and New Testaments to gospels, small portions, and children's resources. And this doesn't include all of the digital distribution. We cover the entire country with a network of 19 Bible Society bookshops, enabling us to reach small villages as well as the urban centers, effectively serving over 2,000 churches. Additionally, we go to book fairs and we have a hotline for free home delivery. Just call 19250. We thank God for all of these wonderful opportunities. And we invite you to partner with us, providing the scriptures in Egypt.
One of the things is many of the things you heard about, I didn't believe could happen. And when my staff suggested them, I thought they were crazy. I'm going to show you something of, we have an interactive Bible museum in our building that's very state-of-the-art, wonderful. It serves the Cairo area. And many of my staff said, we have to do this nationwide. And when they came up with the idea, I thought it was crazy. But this is what they did.
Bible World has served thousands of children over the past years through a hands-on Bible experience, helping them better understand just how the Bible came to us, what it is, and why we should trust it. In order to reach all those children who cannot travel all the way from their remote villages to visit the Bible World in Cairo, we long to create a mobile version that would take Bible World to them. That dream has finally come true. The mobile Bible World provides an unforgettable Bible experience as the comical captain leads them in this exciting quest as Bible World sailors, helping children learn more about God's Word. A trip through five different tent stations establishes the information as to how the Bible was written, who wrote it, how long it took, how it was accurately copied with simple tools, and how it was translated into many languages. Children learn how the manuscripts verify the text in our hands as the very same book that was written thousands of years ago. And they are reminded that they also have a role to play in reading the Bible every day and telling their friends all about it. In our first 2 months, we were able to serve more than 15,000 children in just 3 events in Upper Egypt. Everyone is thrilled with this new Bible adventure. We want to serve tens of thousands of children this year. We invite you to join us in prayer for this opportunity and to help provide the support needed to serve the children in Egypt.
Our Bible World in Cairo serves about 10,000 kids a year. This one, this year alone, has served 35,000 till today. So imagine 35,000 children being able to be taught about the Bible, to be closer to the Bible. And when people say, what about reaching out to Muslims? I say, if we have 35,000 children who love the Lord Jesus, who believe in his word, we don't have to worry about evangelizing, because they're in classrooms with the majority population, and as they shine for Jesus, they will be the missionaries of the present and of the future. So Jesus said, you give them something to eat, but they had only 5 loaves and 2 fish. Ludicrous, right? And that's how many of us, I felt when I have a Bible study started. Our resources are so little. We have so little. But God has done this, and we have watched him do it. So he told them, they sat them down in groups of hundreds and fifties. Very well organized, you know. It couldn't be done unless the people were sitting somewhere where you could reach them. And taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish and looking up to heaven, he gave thanks and broke the loaves. Then he gave them to his disciples to set before the people. So the 12 disciples was the ones who took that basket of food, but they couldn't have taken enough food for 100 people. So what happened? As they distributed, it multiplied. So they were part of a miracle. The miracle wasn't Jesus making food for 5,000 people. It would have taken ages to deliver it. As they delivered, their baskets didn't empty. At least that's the only way one can imagine. And the conclusion is, they all ate and were satisfied. And if you know people in the Middle East, they're not often satisfied unless they eat a lot. So this was really something. They ate and were satisfied. The God of the impossible still asks his followers to take on impossible challenges. And Rebecca, and my challenge to you is, you know, don't get complex about all the things in other countries. There are tremendous needs in Montreal. Yesterday we were at Jacques Cartier metro station, and we saw a sight even Bob and Judy were shocked by, people in outfits that are, you know, it's an understatement to say they were outlandish. Just incredible sight. We felt we were in another planet. And all these people need Jesus. And you might come across them, but you say it's impossible? God can do the impossible. We should notice the needy people around us, physically, emotionally, and spiritually needy. That's the first thing. If you don't notice them, you won't be burdened to reach them. And sometimes Rebecca hadn't noticed these often. Someone brought them to her. So sometimes someone can put a need right in front of you. And I don't know your context, but I'm sure you come across needy people. Then we need to ask God to help us to find a way to minister to him, even if we can't conceive of it. Because to me, all that's happened that we've shared with you, we did not imagine. Rebecca and I didn't sit down, write a plan, and say, we're going to build a school, we're going to do this, we're going to do that. We never did that. Bit by bit, the thing developed from very small seed. The advantage of being around 44 years is the seeds have grown now into big oak trees. And we look back and say, how did this big tree come from this little seed we put? And I'm not exaggerating, a very small thing we did. One person we helped, and then God used them to do a very big ministry. We need to always believe and remember that nothing is impossible for God. He is a great God. And our worship things, hymns this morning related to that. Thank you. You related to that theme. It was God who planned and put his dream in our hearts. And then we watched God do things that we initially thought were impossible. So when you find something impossible, when you can't even dream about how to solve it, put it in God's hands. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for this congregation. We thank you for people here who love you and know you and want to serve you. And the needs around each of us here are very great, greater than we can possibly do. I pray for everyone who's listening today that you may help them to at least meet one need. How to feed a hungry world, they say, one person at a time, rather than getting paralyzed to know there are thousands of hungry people. So help each one here to find the opportunities that you want, even if they seem too little, and to believe in the impossible, because you are the God of the impossible. Amen.